Some people win the game of Survivor by controlling the vote, others by being kind and not backstabbing anyone, and for some, simply by keeping the target off their back. G'day guys, welcome back to Snuffed, where we discuss everything about the greatest game on television, Survivor. Today we'll be sailing back to the Pearl Islands and getting loud to What the Snuff as we relive Sandra Diaz-Twine's journey to the title of Sole Survivor. We first met Sandra Diaz-Twine, a 28-year-old office assistant from Fort Lewis, Washington, as a member of the Drake tribe alongside computer programmer Krista Hasty, 29-year-old art consultant John Dalton, and Rupert Bonham, a troubled teens mentor from Indianapolis. Survivor Pearl Islands began with the 16 castaways on a boat in the waters of Panama. They believed they were going for a photo shoot, but little did they know, they were about to begin a 39-day adventure with only the clothes on their backs. High heels, Armani suits, tie-dye shirts and all. They were split into two tribes and abandoned in a small Panamanian fishing village where they were forced to barter and trade for supplies. This fell into Sandra's favour as she was the only one who could speak fluent Spanish and took the lead with her tough no-bullshit approach, which worked in Drake's favour to pull an impressive haul, even giving up Trisha's eyes for a pot.
The lady at the store had it in for Trisha. Trisha thought the lady was laughing and giggling with her or whatever, but the lady actually, I think, you know, liked her in a sexual way.
This earned Sandra enormous respect from her tribe, proving to be a valuable member. When the tribe arrived on the beach, they were sitting pretty with plenty of supplies and shared some rum on night one. Johnny Fairplay showed himself to be obnoxious and rude, which annoyed Sandra.
I really can't stand him. He talks too much crap all night long, cursing. He thinks it's cute, but it isn't. It gets old. It's already old.
Drake dominated challenges early on, and on day 7, Fairplay suggested that Sandra should sit out of the next challenge because she is a weak swimmer, but she argued she got to shore before him, sparking a massive feud.
I said, when we jumped off the boat the very first day, I had already landed on shore. He was still out there doggy paddling, so he's weaker than I am. But he gets mad. He doesn't want to seem like he's the weakest one out here, which he is.
Okay, we were swimming to shore, I had her glasses in my sock. I couldn't kick my legs, so I swam with just my arms. And how much did you beat me by using your entire body to swim and me just using my arms?
What day?
Day one, swimming from the boat. You beat me by so bad. How much did
swimming
you beat me by?
Swimming to the boat? What are you talking about?
Swimming from the boat when we jumped off the boat and we went to the shore. If you beat me so bad and I just used my arms, how bad did you beat me?
You know what? I can get loud too. What the I can get loud too.
I don't want to argue with you. That's how I'm from
stay
you.
Ball.
You're the one who wants to fight.
The tribe was starting to fracture, so they decided to throw the next immunity challenge and eliminate Burton, who wanted to get rid of the weaker players first. This sent Drake spiraling out of control, losing yet again, sending Michelle home, and again voting out Trish after Sandra rallied to save Rupert following a campaign by Fair Play to eliminate their strongest player. The game was turned on its head when, unbeknownst to everyone, their past came back to haunt them and the Outcasts won a challenge, sending Burton and Lil back into the game, and in the process also send in Sean home from the Drake tribe in a double tribal council. The two tribes merged to form Balboa, and Drake made amends with Burton, also convincing Lillian to join them in voting out Andrew Savage, followed by Ryan O'Prey. Sandra felt that she was on the outs, as she was clearly one of the weaker players and unable to provide for the tribe, unlike Rupert and Burton, who were in the power position. But Sandra, Krista, and Rupert weren't aware that Fairplay had gathered the numbers to blindside Rupert. This caused Sandra to blow up on Fairplay yet again, angrily dumping the fish and making the tribe pay for their decision, deflecting the target off herself and onto her closest ally, Krista.
When we got back to camp, I kept thinking, you know what? They're not coming to enjoy Rupert's fish. Screw that. So I got up to camp first and I grabbed the bucket full of fish and it was so damn heavy. And I trip on a vine and I spill all the fish. And I started arguing with John to the point where it saved me because they never pointed the finger at me as to being the one dumping the fish.
At the loved ones challenge, Sandra's husband Marcus came to visit and she waged war on Fairplay, not believing, or perhaps not caring, about his grandmother, which disgusted Lil and caused the tribe to turn against her. Sandra tried to convince Tawana to betray Burton and John by taking her into the bushes to spy on them, but the men regained favour with Sandra and Krista to vote out Tawana. Lil then informed Fairplay that the Drake women were gunning for him, and as he didn't deem Sandra to be a threat, he rallied numbers to eliminate Krista. She was willing to forgive Lil for her betrayal, aligning with her and Dara to form an all-female final three, and voting out Burton. However, Lil and Dara soon went after each other, and Dara was eliminated for being a massive physical threat due to her individual immunity streak. This left Lil, Fairplay, and Sandra as the final three, and after Lil won final immunity, Sandra pled her case, telling her she was deserving as she had children to take care of, knowing that Lil would vote emotionally and playing into her psyche to eliminate Fairplay, despite Sandra being the known bigger jury threat. At Final Tribal Council, Sandra told the jury that she didn't ride coattails as she spent the majority of the post-merge on the bottom, having lost Rupert and Krista, fighting to survive through adopting her anyone but me strategy. She admitted that, while she'd probably starve to death on the island if left alone, there was always a bigger threat than her which helped her to sneak her way to the end without lying and deceiving and genuinely being a good, honest person. In the end, the votes were tallied and Sandra won in a 6-1 vote to become only the second woman of colour to win and claim the title of Sole Survivor.
The winner of Survivor Pearl Island.
Sandra Diaz-Twine played an under-the-radar game by constantly deflecting the target off of herself and casting the blame on others. Despite her closest allies, Rupert and Krista, going home, she held on until the bitter end through her kind nature and no BS attitude. She very nearly became the first player to complete a perfect game, not receiving a single vote against her across 11 tribal councils. If it weren't for Tijuana casting a lone vote toward Lil, she would have become the first to complete a clean sweep of the jury. Of course, this won't be the last we see of Sandra, as her story is far from over. What did you think of Sandra Diaz-Twine's journey to the title of Sole Survivor? Let us know in the comment section down below. If you enjoy what you've seen, I'd really appreciate it if you give this video a like and consider subscribing to the channel for all the fixins. New videos just like this one every Tuesday and Thursday, 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time. That's Wednesday and Friday, Australian Time. Stay tuned next week as we delve into the story of Amber Burkich, winner of Survivor All-Stars. Sometimes you don't need to pull off any big moves to reach the end. So long as it's anyone but me, grab your torches, head back to camp. Good night.